that okay? Can you hear me? Wow. Okay, so I promise, first of all, that I didn't actually write that for Ruben. And, maybe we could all just vote for him. Thanks, Ruben. I appreciate that very much. And, of course, thank you to all of you for being here tonight. What a heck of a crowd. It means so much to me that you are all taking this time out of your busy lives to be here with us this evening. I also need to start by recognizing and thanking our volunteers. We all know how much volunteers do every day in our communities with churches and charitable organizations and community groups and all the ways they contribute to all of us. I think this is especially true in politics. Regardless of the politicians and the strategists and the talking heads and the pundits, truly nothing could happen or could get done in politics without volunteers. So Ruben already did this, but I had also planned to ask the members of the Lakeland Conservative EDA Board of Directors to rise or to wave to be recognized. They are people from all across the riding. And they are the people who keep things going during this campaign and also all the rest of the time. And there are other people here who have contributed and been active on the campaign in so many different ways, getting this event ready tonight, of course, and other events we've done throughout the campaign, staffing the campaign office in the center of our riding of Two Hills, door knocking with me all over this huge riding, constructing, delivering, and putting up signs, stuffing and stamping envelopes and lit pieces, and so many other things that make everything happen. If I ask all of you to rise or to wave, I think nearly the entire room will stand up, because all of you have, in many ways and in meaningful ways, contributed to our campaign. Of course, most of you know my lifesaver, Tyson Phillips. I'm sorry to do this to you, Tyson. Where are you? Can you yell or wave or stand up or something? Tyson, there! There's my Clark Kent. Tyson does a little bit of everything, and I mean every single thing on our campaign, and spends most of every day and lots of nights, sorry Shane, a ridiculous amount of time with me. So maybe he actually has the toughest job of all, but he really is the key to everything I do. Thank you, Tyson. And of course, Shane and the whole Saskew family, and Kelly Dales, and Cheryl, and Justin, and Monica, and too many to name, are all also central figures to our campaign. So thank you, all of you, and all of you for being here from the bottom of my heart. And what a campaign it has been so far. We have a very large riding, as you know, that spans all the way from Bruderheim to Lloydminster, from Wandering River to Paradise Valley, from Bonnyville to Vegreville, and everywhere in between, including here in St. Paul. Over the past few months, we have traveled, we guess, about 12,000 kilometers, and we have visited 75 communities, usually 6.5 days a week, and we will keep working nonstop until Election Day on October 19th. As you all know, I don't take the outcome of this election for granted at all, not one bit. And I'm committed to earning the confidence of the voters of Lakeland, so we will continue to work. Throughout the nomination and during the election campaign, I have been grateful to connect with many elected representatives across our riding, discussing our mutual priorities, concerns, and challenges. And I am thankful for a number of them who are taking the time to be here tonight, so I'd just like to let you know who those are. So of course, David Hansen, the MLA for Lac-La-Biche, St. Paul, Two Hills. Steve Upham, the Reeve for the County of St. Paul. Maxine Fodness, Councillor for County of St. Paul. Glenn Ockerman, Councillor for the County of St. Paul. Judy Bogdan, Councillor for the Town of St. Paul. Daryl Watt, Reeve for County of Vermilion River. David Gamercy, Councillor for County of Vermilion River. Warren Griffin, Councillor for County of Athabasca, who also lends his wife Nadine to me on our volunteer board. Carl Houch, the Mayor of Bruderheim. Henry Neufeld, the Mayor of Two Hills. Sonny Rajou, Councillor for Two Hills. Mark Kuzman, former Two Hills Mayor. Janelle Saskew, the mayor of Marwane, Ed Sosnowski, the mayor of Murnham, Raymond Uremchek, a councillor from Murnham, Bill Albers, a councillor from the village of Willingdon, he's also taking photos, Adam Kozakavich, councillor from the town of Vegreville, Ruvan Raju, who you heard from earlier, St. Paul Education School trustee, Colette Gascon-Zahar, and Cassidy's mom, Lakeland Catholic School trustee, Steve Zaruski, former MLA for Smoky Lake, Larry Lofstren, former mayor of Glendon, and also just to mention Orville Billis and his wife Teresa, who is the president of our neighboring board in Battleford's Lloydminster for the Federal Conservative Party. And last but maybe not least, I hope you all agree with me, your former MLA, Shane Saskew. And of course, our donors who were recognized earlier and several who you can also see on the signs in the lobby. And yes, just to set the record straight, Shane wouldn't pay that amount to bail me out of jail, never to have supper, never mind, to have supper with me. So as we all know, everybody has strengths in life and in politics. And one of the things I am really not very good at and causes me an unusual amount of heartburn is asking for money. So I am lucky to be surrounded by people who are adept at fundraising and that so many of you are willing to give because of course none of what we do can happen at all without the funds to support it. So all donors who have fulfilled our requests and donated spontaneously in all amounts and in any ways that you have contributed, thank you so much. All that you give makes a real difference to our campaign. And you have donated a tremendous amount, actually, to our EDA and to our campaign over the past several months. And your generosity has made that terrifying fundraising part pretty easy on me, so thank you. But tonight, I do feel, actually, like I can have a bit of a night off. It is not lost on me, let me be clear, that many of you who have joined us this evening, you have joined us to see the person I will introduce in a few minutes. I have to say this same phenomenon happened a little over a year ago when Deb Gray emceed our wedding in Vegreville. For about a week after that day on September 20th, I saw Facebook post after post of pictures and comments of people ecstatic about getting to spend some time with a person they all had long admired, or getting to meet her for the first time, or getting to chat with her personally throughout the evening. And these pictures were all of them with Deb Gray in, well, a beautifully decorated hall, if I do say so myself. And so it was certainly clear to Shane and to me what the real highlight of that day was, actually, to all of them. So thank you, Deb and Lou, for being here with us all the way from beautiful BC and with all the things going on in your lives. And Deb, even though you have taken your time out of politics, for being here with me, for being willing to offer your support, it means a great deal to me, and I know it is the highlight for everyone else here. So tonight will be a little walk down memory lane, probably for many of us, and a time to reflect on where we've been, how far we've come, and about our future. For those of you who helped light the prairie fire of reform, people like Margaret Modine and Guy Bouchard and Gordon Hanna and Ken Suter, who rallied around the call that the West wants in and helped to elect its first member of parliament for this very area where we are tonight in the riding of Beaver River, a person who withstood endless attacks and jeers alone, to then welcome ever-increasing numbers of colleagues to the benches of the House of Commons, even serving as Canada's first female official opposition leader on an interim basis, that evolved into the party that is the Federal Conservative Party in government today. We should reflect on the movement and the party that you all built and on Canada today, because that achievement is in no small part exactly because of all of your efforts. Canada today is a beacon of peace, of freedom, of human rights, of prosperity, of democracy, of opportunity, of equality, and of human dignity. We emanate those values, and our current federal government strives to uphold them internationally and here at home. Despite global economic challenges, Canada is in the strongest financial position of all of the developed countries. We are home to the wealthiest middle class on the planet. Our current government has lowered taxes for all Canadians and families to the lowest level in nearly 60 years and has reduced taxes for job-creating small businesses by the largest decrease in 25 years. And you've probably all seen this according to recent international surveys that told us what I think we all already knew. Canada is considered the best country in the world in which to live and is the most reputable nation in the world. In part, that is because we walk our talk, because we do what's right, because we take principled positions internationally, whether refusing to sit idly by while an international terrorist movement does mass killings, abductions, and torture of religious and ethnic minorities, beheadings of soldiers, teachers, journalists, human rights activists, and humanitarian aid workers, trafficking and enslaving women and children, and directly threatening Canada and Canadians, whether it is in Canada's steadfast support of Israel, or of our Prime Minister looking Putin in the eye and telling him to get out of Ukraine, the fact is that the world respects Canada more than any country on the planet today. And that is because of you. And it is also in part the result of the federal conservative government's tireless focus on priorities, on economic stewardship and job creation, on Canadian values and human rights, on safety and security, including changes to the justice system to put the rights of victims first, all founded on a relentless faith in individual Canadians, their families, their businesses, and local communities. I know I don't need to tell any of you in this room that all of that truly is at stake in this election. This election is particularly critical for us here in Alberta and especially for us in Lakeland. What motivates me every day of this campaign and will always guide me if I am elected on October 19th is this. I believe that our riding of Lakeland is one of the most important regions in the entire country. And I will make it my mission to make sure everyone knows it. I believe you and your families and your friends and your businesses and our communities contribute immensely to Alberta and to Canada. In this riding, as the mayor of Lloydminster once said to me, agriculture is our anchor and energy is our fuel. Our riding is a large part of the economic engine of Alberta, and therefore we, you, make an outsized contribution to Canadians right across our country in terms of jobs, of spin-off activity in other sectors, in food, thank you farmers, in goods and services, in R&D and technology, in innovation, and of course, this is what the lefties seem to forget, of all of that economic activity means revenue for all levels of government, for other provincial governments, and resources for charitable and not-for-profit activities here at home and across Canada. But on top of all of that, to me, you embody the very best of what it means to be Canadian. You're hardworking, you're generous, you're humble, you care, you help your neighbors, you lend a hand, you earn your way, you leave things better for future generations than you found them, you pull together, you contribute to your communities, you know what's best for yourselves, and you make the best decisions for yourselves, for your families, for your churches, for your charities, and together for your communities and for our local needs. You are why we will keep working every single day to the election on October 19th. I will not ask myself on October 20th if we could have done more. Too much is at stake. And so it is extra special to be able to spend this evening with a person who, it can be said, really did start it all. When I was in junior high, as a very cool junior high girl, I started volunteering with our local MP, Kenna, on his constituency association for a few years. He represented the riding of Elk Island, where I grew up, which is also a large chunk of the current riding of Lakeland today. And one evening, my folks came home from one of his fundraisers, where Deb Gray had been a guest speaker. With the financial support of local groups like the Lamont Lions Club, I was heading to Ottawa to participate in the Forum for Young Canadians in a few weeks. And from that fundraiser, my parents gave me a little briefcase that had been bought at the silent auction. In the briefcase was a note and a business card from MP Deb Gray that wished me a good time and told me to visit her office when I was there. So later in Ottawa, I almost chickened out, but my roommate, this is serious, who was a beauty pageant competitor from Toronto and was a member and volunteer with the Federal Liberals, seriously, got us permission to leave the program for a half day to go. So the Liberal beauty queen from Toronto took the Reform 4-H farm girl from Chipman, and she had to stop me crossing the road because the hand was on, but we don't have traffic lights in Chipman, to the Hill for my first meeting with Deb Gray, who then spent an absurd amount of time with me, thinking back on it all these years after, taking me around the Parliament, into the opposition members' chambers, and introducing me to everyone we came across with a non-stop running commentary about all of them. She didn't stop talking the entire time, because not that we have anything in common or anything. And a couple of times that day, I would hear both from my Toronto Liberal beauty queen roommate and others, something that I would come to hear over and over again throughout many years to come. Well, I'm not sure about her politics and I'm not sure about that party, but I sure do like that Deb Gray. I saw Deb off and on at party and campaign events while I finished school, and again when I had the opportunity to work in Ottawa after my first year of university in Preston Manning's office with a group of people, three who work in the most senior roles with the Prime Minister today, and one, Mark Strahl, who remains a good friend and is currently an MP in BC along with his wife Lisa. Then one evening, about a year and a half later, when I had the phone off studying in Edmonton, I checked voicemails to hear that trademark laughing Deb Gray voice admonishing me for not answering the phone and telling me to call her because she had an opportunity in her office she wanted to discuss. The next couple of years, I worked part-time during school, full-time during the summer, and full-time for a while after I graduated university in her constituency office in Edmonton North. There were lots of ups and a little handful of downs, but always a lot of fun, many responsibilities and opportunities, and now lots of memories of a profound and permanently impactful time of my life. She made clear, as you can imagine, like no one else can, what we were there to do. We were there to serve constituents, to help them in any way we could, regardless of jurisdiction or what their concern was, to help them navigate government. They were why Deb was there, and they were why we were there. And she always made sure that was our focus. Privately, Deb is exactly the same person you all know publicly and politically. And let me tell you this, although I wish it weren't so, that is actually a somewhat rare thing among people in politics. She always told me her approach, and I aspire to it. Just be yourself. Tell the truth. Go to source. Don't try to be someone you're not. Don't pretend you know things you don't. But make sure you stand up and speak your mind when you do. Treat everyone the same. And just do your best. So there are many things that are special about tonight, and I know it will be an evening that I will always cherish, and I hope it ends up being the same for all of you. There are so many connections between Beaver River and Lakeland with Deb and between Reform and the current Federal Conservative Party. There is actually a funny little link, in fact, between our Prime Minister, Deb, and then indirectly with me. As many of you probably know, Stephen Harper was once Deb Gray's legislative assistant when she was first elected as the only Reform MP in Canada. He later sat for one term with the MPs of 1993. Many years later, after changes and evolutions and an expansion of our party, I was visiting Ottawa and working in Deb's office there. The phone rang, and I answered it to a clear and cool, "Hello, this is Stephen Harper. Can I speak to Deborah Gray?" Of course, having been a young reformer, I knew exactly who he was and had followed his career later on, so I responded in a not very collected way, "Wait, excuse me, what, you mean like the Stephen Harper?" He paused for a minute and then chuckled and said, yeah, I guess so, but can I speak to Deb, please?" Well, she wasn't in the office at the time, so I said I would pass on the message and get her to return his call when she got back. He said I should probably just give him her cell phone number and that would be fine. At which point, well, I paused and then said, "Actually, I am not permitted to give out her private cell phone number." "And while, of course, I know exactly who you are and totally agree it would probably be okay, I just can't. But I absolutely will give her the message and she will call you back as soon as she can." My stomach dropped as the pause on his end lasted a lot longer than the previous pause, until he started laughing and said, "Well, you are a good little staffer. Please pass on the message and I will hold you to it that she will call me back." Suffice it to say, I did not remind the Prime Minister of this encounter when Shane and I spoke with him for a few minutes at the rally in Edmonton in September. Deb has a plaque that you have all probably heard her quote from time to time. Words by one of Alberta's famous five, Nellie McClung. "Never retreat, never explain, never apologize. Just get the thing done and let them howl." Well, you did, Deb, and all of us are better for it. Please join me in welcoming to the stage our former Member of Parliament and my dear friend, Deborah Gray.
Oh my, thank you. Whoever belongs to these, you can get them later.
I need more room here.
Well, I'll tell you, this is wonderful fun. This is, just so you know, the only campaign event that I am doing anywhere in Canada. So don't you feel special tonight. Since leaving Parliament, I have done some part-time work. I'm semi-retired, I guess. But I'm with the National Speakers Bureau out of Vancouver, so I wander around the country and give keynote speeches all over the place. My agent charges a ridiculous sum for me, and so I'm not allowed to just go and wing it and do a bunch of freebies. But I decided that I would come here tonight because this is where you and I made Canadian history, and because this is where Shannon is running, and she just told you our history. We have a long history with each other. And so when anybody else said, "Oh yeah, we heard you're coming to St. Paul, so please come, we'll have a rally at the Butter Dome or whatever in Edmonton," this is the only campaign function I'm doing this whole campaign. So I'm having fun. Well, you heard about the history in Beaver River. How many of you were here on election night in 1988 when I first ran? And we got seriously kicked, but we sure had a lot of fun losing. It was just great. But then in March of 89, and we'll talk about that for a minute, I became, as Shannon said, the only reformer down in Ottawa. And so Preston Manning used to say, "She's the flag bearer for reform down there." And we had these long talks about whether I would go down or whether Preston would run. But again, he had the smarts when he said, "I could still talk about reform all across the country, but we would have a beachhead down there or a flag bearer in Ottawa if Deb got elected." And so there I went, sitting as a caucus of one for 4.5 years. So I've entitled this "From the Flag Bearer," now this many years later, "to the Torch Bearer," as I passed the torch off and did to Leon Benoit when he came, and he was your MP for a lot of years too. But now we both are passing the torch on to Shannon. Well, I say it's good to be here. It really is. I think sometimes when I'm my age, it's good to be anywhere. I do enjoy it. And thank you all tonight, whoever you are, who, I don't know if you're making fun or not, but you say, "Man, you look good, Deb. You look better than you did when you were in office." Thank you. Whether you're just faking it or not, I don't care. I like that. I appreciate it a lot. It's great. And you know, when I used to come home every weekend, I was 15 and a half years in Ottawa. I spent 13 weekends down there, total. I was back and forth all the time. And I know often, I remember I was in this building sometimes too, and I said, it's so good to be home. And somebody said to me, Deb, people get tired of hearing you say, it's good to be home. Well, you know what? Tough. Because it is good to be here all the time. Any time out of Ottawa, back on a plane here, is always a good time. And Shannon will tell you that in not very long. So I'm home here tonight in Beaver River, or Lakeland, where my most excellent adventure all began. And it's wonderful to see so many friends. Margaret, Ken Suter, it's so good to see you. All political friends, Guy and Lois, it's great. Tom and Erna Holiday couldn't be here tonight. He's getting ready for surgery. He's having something done to his foot. And as you know, I taught school before I got elected. And one of my former students is here, Janine Dennell Hames. How fun is that? To see that she actually lived through me as an English teacher, and she seems to have adjusted quite well in her adult life. So Janine, it's just great to see you guys. It's terrific. Some people have passed on. We have a lot of people from those good old days. We stopped in at the Saskew Farm yesterday on our way out, and Ken Suter had a photo book there that's over there on the table, and oh, we just laughed and laughed and saw all those people. But we all almost had a tear too, because some of those people have passed on. And so anybody in our political lives that we want to honor tonight, I just think we should just take a few moments and just say thank you for their contributions, because they were just as committed to this cause as you and I were. They worked hard, and we appreciate that. Well, I asked for a show of hands in 1988. We didn't have a clue what we were doing. Not a clue. Maybe some of you on the campaign team did, but I sure didn't. We had no idea. We got sent out this enormous box that was a computer printout of the voters list. Remember that? We had no idea what to do with it. So I thought, well, it's heavy. So I threw it in the back end of my car so we'd at least have some ballast on some of these roads. And I thought, well, it seems to work okay for that. We didn't have real phoners. We didn't have really a voter ID. We didn't know what that was. But we just went campaigning, and away we went. It was so much fun. We had some snow. The election was late November that year, November 21st. And so I carried an axe around in the back of my vehicle, and we would just bash in signs wherever. You know, in a snowbank here, they worked really well. It was just great. So we did that, and then I drove around all over the place to all these all candidates meetings. And you heard that Shannon did a pretty good job the other day at hers, and she has several yet to go. But I really enjoyed them because it was kind of fun. And you have to do your homework though on that. Well, of course, I took 6 weeks off, unpaid leave, from Dewberry School where I was teaching. And my roommate Sandra Lawson, who's married to Alan Belsham out in Tullaby Lake Country, she would read the Alberta Report into a cassette tape recorder, blah, 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 every single article. And then I would take them and put them in my truck and I would listen to it. So that's where I got all my ammunition for the debates. Can you believe that? And if they ever thought I knew what I was talking about, woo! That's why, because I listened to it on a cassette tape. It was great. It was terrific. Well, we did such a good job, and of course that was the free trade debate, remember, in 88. The Conservatives won. I came a distant fourth. We did. And as I say, it was sad, but we had so much fun losing. It really was amazing. We worked hard. We had no idea what was coming down the pike next. As many of you remember, John Dahmer, who was here in St. Paul, good fellow, won the nomination, won the election in November, and died 5 days later from cancer. It was very sad. And then we got into a by-election situation. I was back at school already, and the PC board of the County of Vermilion River were not exactly amused by this young upstart pup running for election. And then to say, oh yeah, by the way, we're going into a by-election now, so could you just spot me a couple of months for that? No, they couldn't actually. So away I went, teaching all day, marking Shakespeare essays all night, and then running off all around the riding for the rest of that winter, and then the by-election was held in March of 1989, 4 months later. It was a long, cold winter, and I got really good at bashing in the signs with an axe to the snowbanks because there were a lot of them. Oh, it was long, it was cold. We went to debates all over the place. I learned a lot, and you know what I learned? Mostly, we would spend what we raised. And that was what we believed in back then. Whatever we would raise, that's how much money we had for the campaign. This looked pretty slick tonight. I like this. Too bad this wasn't happening back in 1989. We had a few hot dog sales. Worked great. We had a permanent garage sale going on at all these tables in the offices, which we appreciated too. But I was saying to Shane yesterday, I think the biggest donation I ever got was probably $500. It was $100, it was $50, it was $25 all the time. And that is how we built our campaign. We had enough to win. Because in March of 1989, 4 months later, away we went and made Canadian history. You and I, in March of 1989, where it was, okay, Deb goes to Ottawa now. And I was so excited, I was so exhilarated, but I was so terrified. I went from my classroom at Dewberry School, you had finished in 89 already, but I went back to the school the next morning, and there's CTV, just walking down the halls of Dewberry School. And I just thought, oh dear, they got here before me. They knew how to find me, because I was actually going to have a little chat with the principal to see if it was okay if I left and went to Ottawa. Mercifully, he said, I think we could work out a leave. So I appreciated that. But I remember all my students. I had a grade 8 or 9 home room, and they were all outlining the hallways, and I had done just fine all the night before and all night. But when I got to my school at Dewberry and I saw them all lining, I knew my life had turned upside down right then, and I probably would never be coming back to Dewberry School. And I had no idea what the kids or the teachers were going to say, but when they went down, they said, here comes Deb Gray. And I walked in, and I remember some of the kids, many of whom you know, they said, way to go, Miss Gray, you smoked them. And I thought, oh, that makes a good clip on the national news. So that was perfect. I didn't even coach him that way. So away I went to Ottawa. What a memory. What a memory. We made Canadian history. Then I realized I actually wasn't coming back to Dewberry School, and I had to go to Ottawa. My life turned upside down that night. You, Beaver River, Lakeland, call it what you will, took a chance on me, Shannon said. I hired a guy named Harper. I had met Stephen before. He was our chief policy officer. But Preston just said to him, pretty bluntly, she just got elected, she doesn't have a clue. So she needs a lot of help. And I would second that remark for sure. So Stephen said, no, I'm in the middle of taking my master's degree in economics, I'm not going. But it worked out okay because the spring session was then, so he was finishing in April. And so he said, all right, Preston warmed down and he said, I'll go for 1 year. And if you looked at the pay stubs this many years later, I bet that's exactly how long he worked there. And then he went back and finished his master's degree. And I've done okay with employees, it seems. You know who he is now. We had a reunion of the class of 93, a couple of however many years ago that is, in 2013. And Leon Benoit organized it. It was out in Canmore. We just had a wonderful time. And I was asked if I would introduce Stephen because he was there. He was part of the class of 93. And I was able to look at him and say, I was your boss, you were my assistant, now you are my prime minister. Can you imagine what that does to a girl? Forget about how he felt. It was quite an experience. But you know, being in politics isn't easy. Shannon could tell you this, but she's gonna learn a whole lot more. She's learned a little bit from Shane. But it isn't easy. It isn't easy at all. And I say these things when I'm out speaking sometime, like the little girlie who said, Daddy, Daddy, do all nursery rhymes begin with once upon a time? And he said, oh no, sweetheart. Most of them begin with, if elected, I promise to. And then what's the difference between a politician and a trampoline? You have to take your shoes off to jump on the trampoline. Right. And then, I don't know if I dare use this, but because it's harvest and because we used it in 1993 and because I didn't make it up, they say, how many politicians does it take to grease a combine? Do you remember this one from 93? Three, maybe four, depends on how slow you feed them in. Oh, this was so long ago, they're starting to be fresh again. I can tell these same jokes over and over. Ronald Reagan said, you know, politics is not a bad profession. If you succeed, there are many rewards. If you disgrace yourself, you can always write a book. And I did, and I got a whole pile of them out there at the back. Some of you bought them already, thank you, I appreciate that. But you know what? I'd like to sell them all tonight. I don't know, we have a few dozen there. And I'm selling them for 10 bucks. You could pick mine up at the back. I'll write on it. And I'm going to donate every dollar that these books raise. I know it's like, not exactly like bidding on supper. There's quite a few zeros in that. I'm not good at math, but it's a lot. But whatever we sell on those books tonight, I'm just going to donate them to Shannon's campaign, the cash. So if you do that. Plus, I don't want to take them all home, okay? So just get rid of those. I was known back then, if any of you remember, as the 36-year-old single high school teacher from Hinesburg, Alberta. As if that was one adjective. Well, look at me. I mean, look at me. You people say, oh, Deb! It's reversed. I was the 36-year-old teacher. Guess what? On July 1st, I just turned 63. I don't know how that happens. I have no idea how that happens. I am 63 years old. Tom Holliday, many years ago now, did a Burma shave sign. You know, I lived at Laurier Lake on the North Beach there, and they held a party for me on July 1st, and he had these signs all the way along saying, she ain't 36 no more. Now look at me. But you know what? We know someone here tonight. She is about to turn 36, and she's going to turn it upside down just like I did with you back then. Shannon, I've known you, I think, for half your life. That's a while. I want to tell you tonight who she is. She's Shannon. And I want to tell you what she is. She's just conservative. And I want to tell you who you all are together. You are Lakeland. So who she is, Shannon. Yes, she's a strategic thinker. You know what? She is smart. She knows how to figure it out. She can frame an issue, she can formulate policy, and she can communicate the main ideas. You just saw how she did that. Catch an all candidates debate coming up. They say there's six left, go find one, and you'll agree with me and say you bet. She is a strategic thinker. H, she's hardworking. Everybody knows that. Shannon worked in my office, she told you what an excellent boss I was, or a taskmaster saying, this is what's important, do that, and the rest of it probably doesn't matter a whole lot. How do I know she's hardworking? Because she worked for me. I was her boss. You could figure out if somebody's just horsing around, wasting time. She worked hard. She worked in my constituency office, as she said, in Edmonton North when she was going to university. She had no car. Hello? She was an adult. She couldn't drive for, I don't know how long. How old were you when you got your driver's license? 31, right? While we're on that topic, let me digress. Some of our friends from Mundare wanted to spank the Conservatives at the last provincial election, so they voted NDP. And they said to us, Deb, we had no idea that was going to happen. Like you and 100,000 others felt the same way. Anyway, their new MLA, I think she's almost 35. She's never driven. She has no license. And she's just busy getting chauffeured around while she figures out how to drive because she's in a large rural constituency. Way to go. Shannon got her license, thank goodness, after a while. There's an A in there, and she's an activist in the best sense. She told you she was involved as a young kid in reform. She was our national convention speaker in 1998 in London, Ontario. She was still a teenager. And they gave her the honor of introducing one Preston Manning. That's not bad. Isn't that amazing? As a teenager, they saw that there was all kinds of potential in this young woman, and she got to introduce Preston. She helped build the Wild Rose Party from the ground up, as you know, and recently she's been active in promoting property rights for Alberta farmers. And you know what? She's nice. That sounds so corny, but it's so true. She was a nice kid. And you know what? Not all kids are nice kids. But she always was, as long as I've known her. She is engaging. She has a ready and infectious laugh. Someone said tonight they recognize my voice because they used to hear me on the radio. Well, with Shannon and me, we have a few things in common. You can generally hear us coming before you see us coming, and so that's her. I was in a shop recently, and a neighbor came out of the next aisle and said, "There's a voice I recognize. Hi, Deb, how are you?" We were at the Shemanis Theater. We could say the same thing about Shannon's laugh. Maybe not the next aisle over, but the next building over. You'll hear her come. And you know, part of that is electability. That is a huge factor, and she has it. And another N, she's neighborly, and that's good. You know what I'd say, because this to me is big, because it's big to her? She'd board your horse for you. Anytime, probably free, happily, and she understands community. She knows rural, like all of us know rural, and that is huge, it's a big factor. Then there's an O, she's open. She'll always tell you what she's thinking. Right, Shane? Always. But she will always listen to your side and respect it. And that is huge. And then the final end there, she's nobody's fool. Nobody's fool, and that's big. She's smart. She knows who she is. She knows what's right. She has that plumb line that hangs true that all of us have. And if you just stray a little bit this way or a little bit that way, you always know you have to get back to that plumb line that hangs absolutely true. And that's Shannon. Don't mess with her. The welcome mat is always out, but don't ever wipe your feet on her. It would not be pretty. But you know what? It's going to be really helpful when you get to Ottawa. You're going to need that factor a whole lot. Okay, so that's who she is. What she is, she's a conservative. So there's a C. She is a conservative. We as conservatives believe in cutting taxes, not raising them. Remember the GST? It was so long ago, it was 7%. Then it went to 6. Now it's been at 5 for years. I like that a whole lot. Why? Because we get more money in our pockets. But you know why else? It's way easier to figure out. You know, I had to do 7, so I'd say, okay, 10, and then 1% of that, and 5 is... And I just thought, that's way too much. So thanks, Stephen, for lowering that to 5%, because it makes it simple. You divide by 10 and then divide by half again. And Lou and I just bought another car, and we paid a whole lot in GST, and we live in British Columbia, so we paid a whole lot in PST as well. But I like that 5% GST, and that's just kind of ancient history. But let's not forget it. That's a chunk of change. The tax-free savings account, that's a fabulous deal. The NDP will snarl and say, oh, it's just the rich. Or Mr. Trudeau will say, oh, it's just only rich people that do it. And they show the tables. Ordinary, regular, working folks, they are putting money in there because why pay taxes if you don't have to? And I think that's just terrific. And we've heard some of the other parties say, well, bust that up. Yikes. I love it. I love that. And they just doubled the allowable amount you can put in. That's terrific. Pension income splitting for seniors and families, that's a fabulous deal. It's a terrific deal. My husband, Lou, where are you, hon? I saw you stand up a while ago. Oh, there he is in the back. He has books, okay? And he's not gonna let you walk out of that door, okay, until you buy books, so that's cool. But Lou just turned 67 years old. He says he really appreciates getting a sympathy check from the government every month. It's terrific. But because he's a senior, you're able to income split, and with young families, that's just absolutely a terrific deal. The Canadian Child Tax Benefit, $120 a month for 5 and under, and $60 a month for kids 60 to 17. That is a sweet deal, and I appreciate that, because conservatives cut taxes, not raise them. Conservatives, oh, objective. I like to think that we have a brain and that we could be objective about things. We see the big picture. Shannon, as a Conservative, just doesn't throw money at the noisemakers. Spends money where necessary, and you know what? Here's a novel idea. We don't spend it where it's not necessary. That is a Conservative and only a Conservative. Well, here, forgive me as an English teacher, but this N for Conservative we'll say is knowledgeable. K-N, it's close enough. Stephen Harper knows his stuff. I told you, he was an economist. Shannon has talked about him. He is a very bright fellow, and he understands this. I have a lot of friends in cabinet still who say we have to go and brief the Prime Minister on something, and they know they better do their homework before they go in there. They go in there, and he just starts like this. Wham, wham, what about this? What about that? And he seems to know more than they do about what the issue is they thought they were going to brief him on. So he understands it. He knows it. His two brothers, Grant and Robert, and his dad, Joe, who when I first went to Ottawa, Joe, Stephen's dad, would come over from Toronto because he liked doing research at the archives, and he would just set up shop in my office. He just took a little corner, helped himself, and said, this is so nice to have an office on Parliament Hill. And I thought, yeah, I bet it is. We're paying your boy, and I got elected. What's your story? Anyway, he was a great fellow. They were all chartered accountants. And Stephen has said that he didn't have the personality to be a CA, so he became an economist. That's good. So S, Conservatives are solid, rock, rib, solid. Know what you pledge, and pledge what you know. Don't blow it with the polls. There's, did you hear someone who just said, hey, we're gonna run deficits, because someone in a poll said maybe that wouldn't be bad. That is ridiculous. You can't just blow around with all the polls. Somebody just saying, well, we'll run modest deficits for 3 years, wrong. Let me say this, that Stephen Harper does not give a sweet fig what the United Nations thinks of him. He doesn't care. He doesn't care what they think. He knows what his mission is to do, and it was mentioned earlier, to go up to Putin and say, I'm not going to shake your hand, you're basically a thug. That is a guy who is comfortable and confident in himself that says, I don't care. I know what my mission is. I like that. He stands solidly, and he votes according to it. E, then, is excellence. In matters of money and security, the Prime Minister's job is not a level entry job. He realizes that there are consequences for all of our actions. We have roots, R for roots, as Conservatives. We know where we come from. We spend less, and we bug people less. That's about the best way I could think to put it. Spend less, bug people less. And that's what I think people like. Conservatives are viable, not ridiculous, lavish promises. I just get so sick of people saying, oh, we'll do this. It's like, I'll see you and I'll raise you. This isn't a poker game we're running in this country. We want viable leaders who will not say, I'll see you and I'll raise you. You've seen people like that. You've seen them in your personal lives. You've seen them in your business lives. And you're watching them right now live in political life. How far do they go? And then how far and how fast do they fall? We have a huge decision to make in October, folks. And I am just hoping and praying and confident that we will have a Conservative majority government, because the two opposition leaders have said already publicly, if it's a minority Conservative government, we're not holding them up. You know what that means? They're going to bring them down in the House of Commons and have another election right away. Let's save the time and trouble. Let's make sure that we get a good Conservative majority government and that they will be stable and secure for another 4 years, 5 years. Allegiance. An A for allegiance to Canada. Now, there's a concept. Let's be allegiant to Canada and to Israel for what's happening over there and promoting our safety. Israel is in big trouble right now. There is a terrorist threat, certainly against them, but against our country as well. And I just want to say, as somebody who has served on the Security Intelligence Review Committee in Ottawa for 2 years, I just finished in the spring, I know what's going on behind the scene. Our job was to monitor and review CSIS and make sure that they were abiding by the Canadian law and the CSIS Act. Let me tell you folks, I know some of the stuff that's going on here in our soil, and I want to say thank you as a Canadian citizen to our Prime Minister who has not said, bring these guys in. They will need security checks, because I guarantee to you, in every one of those boats, in every one of those groups coming over, there are sleepers for cell groups who want to come into Canada that way. And we must say, no, you're welcome here, but you will go through the security checks and make sure we do not have terrorists sneaking in our borders. Oh, there we go, Gavin. Woo! Great. I could tell you stories that would curl your hair, but guess what? It was all top secret. I can't tell you a thing. T stands for thoughtful. Does my government really care about me? I don't want a personal call. I don't want the Prime Minister to say, hi Deb, how are you doing? Are you happy? No, I don't. I want to know that they are looking after my best interest, my family's best interests and friends. Lou and I have two darling little grandbabies right now. Little Emma is 3. And little Colby, her sister, is 1. And their main concern in this life right now is when Nana and Gramps come and they say, will you take me to the park right now? That's important to them right now. But it's important for me to know that when they're 20, 30, 40, 50, that there is going to be a Canada that I am just as proud of now as they will be when they're little old ladies like myself. I don't want someone in there that's going to start engineering society as an experiment on my behalf. Thank you very little. You know, keep that to yourself. I don't want it. Go find another rat for that lab. I wrote that line myself. An eye for intelligent. You want smart guys in charge. You know, it sounds so stupid that you would have to say that, but it's true. We want smart guys that know what they're doing in Ottawa. We don't want angry, we don't need pretty, but smart, we want smart there. And then a V, of course, for victorious. You want to back a winner, and you know what? You have that in Stephen Harper, who is a world statesman. Just got an award for being a world statesman. That's pretty impressive. We're number 1 in the OECD, Forbes number 1, GDP growth number 1. That's not half bad when you look and see what's going on around the world. Canada is in terrific shape. And then E for economy, a balanced budget. And then Rev Canada came out just, I don't know, whenever it was, 10 days ago, and said we have a $1.9 billion surplus. What would a conservative say? Good, we need that money to be careful, to be prudent with, and we'll just split it up smart. There was this guy who talks about how much he was in the Quebec government, but now he's the leader of the opposition. He says, oh, that's great. I heard him on TV say, what a great thing for me to have for a start as your prime minister. And I just thought, that is not your petty cash, honey. You know, like $1.9 billion. And he said, that's just great. Thank you very much. I'll take that pot and away we go. We'll just start dishing it out. Shame on him. Small business. Now, somebody else on the campaign trail said that small business, he's pretty, said small business is a tax haven for big corporations. How many of you have small businesses? How many of you are hiding them and they're havens for your great big corporation? That a boy. We have one. He's honest, I like that. Can you imagine? Like the nerve of somebody who said, I'm all for the middle class. He who wouldn't know a middle class if it tripped over his foot. You know, I mean, it's just bizarre. And a lot of people say, oh yeah, we're gonna vote for him. Yikes. We have cut taxes for small business from 11 to 9. That's down 46% since 2006. Payroll taxes down 20%. These are amazing figures, especially when we went through the 08 recession there. This is amazing, and people need to hear this. So that's the conservative, that's what she is. And then who you are and what you all are together. You are Lakeland. So the L stands for loyal. You are loyal people. I know that. I don't even need to come around and ask you a bunch of questions and give you a little form. You're loyal. You're loyal to your family. You're loyal to your friends, your faith, your community groups, because that's who we are out here in rural Canada. I see it some in the city. I don't live in a city. My town is, how big is St. Paul now, roughly? 5,000? Well, Lou and I live in Qualicum Beach, and it's around 8,000 or so. And then we have to go on field trips down to Parksville, which is 15,000, when we want to go have coffee at night, like A&W or Tim's or something like that. We go on field trips. So I don't live in a big city either. But I'll tell you this, these are rock solid people, many of whom have retired out there from Alberta. You will be there for your family, your friends, and you know it. If you need help, you know who to call, don't you? We know that we can trust these people. We are loyal. And A, you're appreciative. You and I are really grateful to be Canadians. I know that. And if you aren't, and you're ever going to start just grousing just a tiny bit, watch the news, okay? Just turn on Peter, which should be enough to pretty well wake you right up. And just any of the newscasts, and yes, they're biased, and yes, but you know what? When you see some of the stuff that's going on around the world, this is a pretty special place. And I am so happy to go anywhere. We're not exactly globetrotters, but when Lou and I do go somewhere, we are so proud to be able to say we're Canadians. And when I watch what's going on down south here, this is going to be really something. If that's Stephen, tell him Shannon and I are busy right now, okay? That's the way, no problem. So the K in Lakeland, this is legit now, you know lots. You know lots about stuff. You know what's going on. You're smart. You pay attention to what's going on. So you can smell a rat. You can. A lot of people can. A lot of people don't have any idea what's going on. And people can come in and just bamboozle them. But you know a lot. And you're not going to get fooled by it. You can smell a rat. E, you're energetic. You like to work. You like to play. You like to play fair. And you want your government to do the same. Again, that sounds so basic, and you think, yikes, do we have to talk about that? Yeah, we do. We do, because people just say, oh, you know, look at him, he's promising this. Yes, he's at a rally. Yes, he knows how to walk up an escalator. I love that one. I haven't spoken in a campaign for a long time. I can't believe what I'm actually saying. That wasn't in my notes. But anyway, I'm not running for office, so who cares? As if that was any different than when I was your member of parliament. I pretty well said whatever came out anyway. You want your government to do the same. So the next L is you look up and not down. Again, that's pretty basic. But do you know how many people you come in contact with sometimes and they say, oh, it's terrible. Oh, it's this. Oh, it's so bad, I'm getting old and I got aches and pains and dear knows what all. But you look up. Have you watched that? This is amazing. CBC has a new show out called Still Standing. Have you seen it? That's Johnny Harris. I love him. Yay for the CBC. No, yay for Johnny Harris and Still Standing. He is Detective Crabtree on Murdoch Mysteries, which Lou and I find to be another good CBC show that we watch because we love it. But old Johnny, he's so cute, he's going around the country and he's finding these woe-begone towns who have had all kinds of heartache. It looks like they're just going to blow apart at the seams. And he goes and he makes them feel good about themselves. And they're all able to look up. They love the comedy show he does. He just does an amazing job with that. And I love that about that. They still keep fighting and they still keep looking at the bright side. And they just love it when he comes. Farmers are the most optimistic people I know. We have friends right now down in Dewberry, they haven't started combining yet, it's still too tough. And I looked at today, I'll tell you, and I thought, I'm out of here. This is freezing. It was like +3. And I just thought, this is awfully cold, and I don't even have long johns, I don't even have a parka here with me. But they say, we'll get it off, we'll get it off. Don't know how long it'll take, don't know what the grade will be, but you know what? We're going to get that crop off. Optimistic to the end. Always next year, if this year isn't so great, there's always next year, it'll be just fine. And you're Oilers fans, so you know you can prove it. You know, I'm not good at math. I never was, never will be. Never care to be, actually. But this is what I can't figure out. How many years in a row are you so bad that you get first pick and you get first pick again next year? That's because you're optimists. Like I say, you look up and you don't look down. And for A, you are above average. And you need to know that, and you need to celebrate that. In every sense, generally, our income is above average. Lots of times our health is above average. Our attitudes, our lifestyle. And we're pretty blessed to be living where we are and doing what we do, whatever it is. And when I think about being able to come here tonight, I've been away for years, and then all of a sudden it's like a snapshot just coming back. And I just look at people and say, we are so blessed. I look at John and Carolyn Euchin. They fed us tonight. When they said they were coming to cater, I said, I'll be there. Even if Shannon can't make it, I'll be there. Johnny, would you get your gang and bring them out? They could use a break from dishes. We'll keep an eye on that. And then N, for the second N in Lakeland, you never say never. And I like that. And I've been with people, boy, I'll tell you over the years, they just, it's never going to work. It's not going to work. We tried that in 1969. What makes you think it's going to work now? It's just bizarre. It's just absolutely bizarre. We went through a merciless recession. We're going through low oil prices right now. Lots of tough storms, but you weather them just like you ought to do and be proud of it. Look at those guys. Thank you for supper. Thank you guys. That was delicious. And well, while I'm on that topic as well, I might as well talk about Shane and Shannon's wedding last year. This was the best thing ever. I love words as a teacher, of course, an English teacher. And so when I met Terry Hill, married to Jerry Hill from Harry Hill, who was the caterer, how could I not have some fun with that? But when she told me that she and her sister made 160 dozen pierogies by hand and probably the same number of cabbage rolls, I thought, you could not pay me enough to make those things. And they looked perfect. They looked like they all came out of the little Chemo machine. Just amazing. It was great. I loved it. And I'm so glad you're still married, okay? That would look bad on me as your MC. So I love them both. No matter what, you never say never. And D, you are democratic in your personal lives, in your professional lives. And we realize that in terms of democracy, government ain't perfect. Of course not, it never is. But we get to choose them. And this election is the closest we've had in, I'd say, a generation. We need to choose wisely. And you need to tell folks you know right across the country, from sea to shining sea, that they had better be careful about who they elect. Because if it's a minority conservative government, the other guys think it's cute or something to bring us down. And then you're right back into another election. That's ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. And in terms of security, we need that consistency. And in terms of making sure that our tax laws stay the same, Justin says he's gonna just, oh well, we'll cancel that program. Mulcair says, oh, okay, well, I'll spend the money on that, and we'll have daycare for something or other. No, we need to choose wisely. So in this riding, I know you're going to choose wisely. You're going to work right to the last day. But tell people across the country that they need to make a very wise choice. Because we don't want to regret it. We don't want to regret it. We don't want to lose the status that we have in the world. Well, in conclusion, as they often say when they're just winding up for another 40 minutes. I really am winding down. And I'm going to tell you this. Shannon Stubbs is worthy of being your Member of Parliament. She is smart. She possesses that wonderful quality that I mentioned of electability that the voters want to see. She has a faithful and unwavering supporter in her husband, Shane Saskew, and the whole gang behind. And there's lots of them. She is ready to go and make some noise in Ottawa on behalf of you, Lakeland, Alberta. So tonight, as I was the flag bearer, 1989, that's I think 26 years ago, and I've done a reverse from 36 to 63, and I just think about all the people who have had such an impact on my life. Sue worked in my riding office, St. Linda. Somebody said, Linda Hansen is St. Linda? And I said, yeah, she is, because I had a Linda that stayed at our house out at the lake sometimes. I had Linda in Ottawa, and then I hired Linda Hansen here in my riding office in St. Paul. And poor Lou, when the phone would ring in Edmonton, he didn't know who was whom. So he dubbed her St. Linda. So we knew that she was from St. Paul. And she's still St. Linda this many decades later. It's great fun. So as I was that flag bearer that many years ago, tonight I am a torch bearer to pass it on. I did this for Leon Benoit years ago when he took over, and I'm sure you remember that. And we wish him well in his retirement. He's done a great job. Thank you, Leon, wherever he is tonight, for his years of service. We appreciate that. And as I was that flag bearer at Reform's beginnings, I'm now the torch bearer, Shannon, to pass it to her as your next member of parliament. And finish with a poem called The Bridge Builder that was recited to me right after I got elected in 1989, and I went down to Calgary to the head office for this big bash. I was terrified. I was on my way to Ottawa. I didn't have a clue what I was doing or what I was supposed to do. And this old fella came. His name was Douglas Campbell. He was one of the original progressives in 1922. I think he was 93 years old. They brought him out from Manitoba. He'd been the premier after that. Were you there, Ken? What a night that was. I was 36. I was so scared. And yet I knew that I had you all behind me. So I knew I could conquer the world. And he passed this torch to me. And I pass it on to you now tonight, the bridge builder. An old man going a lone highway came at the evening, cold and gray, to a chasm vast and deep and wide, through which was flowing a sullen tide. The old man crossed in the twilight dim. That sullen stream had no fears for him. But he turned when he reached the other side and built a bridge to span the tide. Old man, said a fellow pilgrim near, you're wasting your strength in building here. Your journey will end with the ending day. You never again must pass this way. You've crossed that chasm deep and wide. Why build you the bridge at the eventide? The builder lifted his old gray head. Good friend, in the path I have come, he said, there followeth after me today a youth whose feet must pass this way. This chasm that has been naught to me, to that fair-haired youth may a pitfall be. He too must cross in the twilight dim. Good friend, I am building the bridge for him. Good luck, Shannon. I love you.